what it is, how it works, you know, how to use it, these kind of things. But the main thing we want to look at today, we want to look at water. Okay. Yes, we're going to look at 3, 4, 5G technology and all this because it's part of it. And we're going to tie all of this together. But again, the main thing we want to talk about today is water, because I'm going to probably say it a bunch of times throughout the day, through this presentation. No matter how much we say about water, we can't really overstate its importance. And this is what we want to look at today. And I hope you'll get a lot out of this. I actually learned quite a bit more and more, of course, as I explore and we explore here at the RLT about water. We keep learning. And so we want to share some of this with you. And hopefully this will show you some things about yourself and water that you might not have known before. And rather than, because I said, like I said, water is the most important part of this conversation today. So we're going to go into the coMra wave technology, but only, let's say, peripherally, in the sense that there's a lot you can just take the time to look at for yourself. So we don't need to go through it all here. But what I wanted to do, I'm going to start with the video. It's 5 minutes. And it's just going to walk you through the coMra wave technology so you have some context for what follows. And then we'll get into the real, let's say, meat and potatoes of the thing about water. Okay. So here we go. And just someone let me know, make sure you hear the audio, please.
Our latest project tackles the growing concern about the negative health effects of communication technologies. And this is things such as 5G, for example. So in this presentation, I'm going to explain the challenge as we see it and present to you our solution introducing the coMra wave. coMra wave converts harmful electromagnetic radiation into harmonic waveforms that re-energize body and mind. Why should we be concerned about electromagnetic radiation? There have been many scientific and medical studies to determine the long-term health effects of harmful electromagnetic radiation, EMR, or electrosmog for short. This is from digital devices such as mobile phones, Wi-Fi networks, TV, and satellite, to name a few, and their effects on our general psyche and well-being. How is electrosmog harmful? It's all about the water. Radiation from Wi-Fi, 3, 4, 5G, GSM, and all other digital technologies make the structure of water, and this is both in our bodies and what we drink, chaotic and unhealthy. What does that mean? For example, through water, the body replaces 50 billion cells every single day. Water also helps the DNA replication process to prevent errors in our DNA. This helps with anti-aging and the prevention of tumors. We also know that there's an intricate dynamic network of bonds in water, creating a structure like the electric activity of the brain. This dynamic structure gives water its healing properties, and it serves as a mediator in every biological process. In short, water is alive and is the key to all healing effects in the body and mind. coMra wave technology tackles the problem by rebalancing the natural structure of water in a very unique way. Firstly, coMra wave devices absorb harmful electromagnetic radiation from nearby digital devices, thus giving you a level of protection by having it close to you. Secondly, it converts that absorbed electrosmog into a harmonic waveform signature. That's stored in a device until it comes in contact with water. Because of the sensitive nature of water, that signature is then imprinted back into your body, into your drinking water, or into any water-containing structure. The new vortex signature imprints in a nearby water or water-containing structures to produce a closer state of water as it is in nature. So, is this for real? Yes, most definitely. We've tested safely and successfully our technology in the lab, with people, with pets, and with plants. We've gathered user feedback from a pilot run involving hundreds of people over the course of 7 years. We've tested with a range of scientific approaches, nuclear magnetic resonance, which is an MRI for substances, so nuclear magnetic resonance, microwave spectrum analysis, as well as microwave power analysis, and dissolved oxygen tests. The results from all of these tests show that coMra wave technology rebalances the quality of the water closer to that of water in nature. Economical and ecological, coMra wave technology does not require any batteries, doesn't have any moving parts. It's completely passive and self-powered, using the ambient electromagnetic radiation as its power source. The longevity of the devices depend on physical wear only. Take care and they'll serve you for a lifetime. We all want a more natural life. We're using research into life's natural order as well as its dynamics. The products and the services we offer are based on this research. And it's our hope that they will inspire everyone into finding a more natural cooperation between man, nature, and technology. Your support in this makes all the difference. Please spread the word. Thank you.
So, there you have it. That's the overview of the coMra wave technology. And when we talk about spread the word, really today I'm speaking about that in the context of water. Spread the word about water. I hope you'll take something away from today that opens, let's say, gives you a new perception about water that you never had before. And spread the word about that, because I mean, water is, yeah, it's quite amazing, as we'll go into right now. So we're going to go into the importance of water in the body and how it influences your health and what you can do about it. Now, usually when you think about water, you know, people think, okay, is clean drinking water? Absolutely. Hydration, this is very important, but there's a lot more to it than that. So what we're really talking about is, I want you to think of, you know, we get taught that water is kind of the background and everything happens on the foreground and water's in the background. But really what we're going to show you today is water is actually the main character of the whole show in the body, and we'll stick to the body for today. In other words, it's the central character, not the background on which the play happens, but it's the central character in the whole play of what happens in the body. So this is, it's not new, but it's taken a long time for science to come around to this. So we want to talk about that, and then we want to get into how that relates to our functional reserves. Now, if you've been on the calls before, you looked at Arjan's book, you've done the courses, you remember functional reserves, and go over it a little bit for those who haven't. Our functional reserves are basically, it's the body's ability to heal itself, okay? So we want to make sure the more functional reserves we have, the better able the body is to heal itself. So we want to talk about that. And then, yeah, let me just show you this piece right near here. Now let me go to that slide. When you think of water, okay, in the body, and I said it's the main character, the central actor of the whole show. When you think about, okay, so it's 2/3 and 3/4 water, that's very significant. And you can see how this plays out in the different kinds of tissues. But then when you think about it in a different way, if you count out all the molecules in the body, you count them one by one, actually it'll be 99% of the molecules in the body are water. So obviously it's a super beyond important role, and we want to acknowledge that. And today, like I said, we're going to go into that about its central role. So let's go into the I'm going to go non-technical with the functional reserves today. So we're going to call it energy dollars. Now, by that, let's take, we have on the slide, you start with $100 a day. Now, our choices impact our energy dollars. So in other words, you know, someone drinks alcohol for a week straight, obviously their functional reserves are going to be decreased. If I'm stressing out about something for 2 weeks, that's going to decrease my functional reserves. Conversely, if I'm making good, healthy choices, I'm really giving myself the TLC that I need, this is going to increase functional reserves. And of course, there's things we can do to support that in many different ways. Now, that $100 is shared between me, Garrett, and my body. So they're not the same. I'm inhabiting, anyway, we won't go into that. And when I hit zero, if we hit zero, myself and or my body hit zero, I need to get that energy from somewhere. Now, that $100, let's look at it this way. And we go back to the functional reserves model that Arjan talked about. $10 for digestion. Let's say it's around $60 for your brains and your muscle. Your immune system, just idly, when it's not active, and we're talking about a healthy person here, it's much different if someone has a chronic illness. A healthy person, their inactive immune system, just sitting there on idle, 10%. So we've already used $80 out of every day just for the basics. So that's how a budget works. Now I have $15 to $20 left. What are we going to do with it? How do we increase it? Because when you look at, when you hit zero, you need a loan, okay? And when we think about that, if you think about, let's say, a short-term energy deficit. So this is when we get the flu and these kind of things, obviously really relevant with the COVID in terms of we want to keep our immunity, we want to keep our functional reserves or our energy budget in a good shape so that we don't dip into that fund. Because if we do it for a short term, we can have mild illness. Whereas if we do it, like you see here on the screen, long-term deficit, in other words, if you draw, if I draw, if anyone draws from that energy budget, once it hits zero, you have to get the money from somewhere, and you get it from your cells. Your cells give up the energy. So you've heard me say before, you know, everyone has their own individual Achilles heel, that thing that will show up in terms of symptoms first and foremost in their lives. So when you think about that Achilles heel we all have, like for me, it'll be, it's not so much anymore, but I used to get neck pain and, you know, shoulder checking would be difficult, these kind of things. It'd be where I hold my stress. So this would be my Achilles heel. And that would be the indicator that I'm stressing that tissue in my body. It's holding the stress, which means those cells are not operating at their maximum capacity. So then we look at this energy budget. We want to increase it because obviously this is going to lead to us having a better quality of life. And, you know, obviously to experience joy and enjoy our lives, we need health, some degree of health. Now, this is also not about beating ourselves up to do everything perfect. It's really a journey of adjustment. You know, we do things that work for us for a while, and then let's say they reached their sell by date, and then takes us a while to figure out that they reached their sell by date to move on to do something new. So it's that, it's a process, okay? So this is the context I want you to kind of keep in mind. We want you to keep in mind when we're going through the slides about this energy budget, this, and we'll come back to it. I'll mention it a number of times, okay? So now when we look at water, water is the main reservoir of energy in the body. Now, let me elaborate on that a bit, please. This isn't like theoretical or practical. This is, or, you know, hypothetical. This is factual and practical, okay? Think about it this way. You can't just take energy out of your pocket and use it. It has to be stored somewhere and available. Now, you know, you can think in your body, think of fat stores. So those are energy storage, okay? But it's a very long term, takes quite a while to burn off fat. So that would be one type of energy storage in the body. Then there would be, let's say, food again, that's a bit faster energy storage and release, and the body metabolizing things and making use of it in the cells. Then you have, let's say, ATP, which is the energy molecule in the cell, and that's very fast too. But there's an even faster, and what I mean by faster is that energy is available now. Now, for you and I, you know, time scales are measured in minutes and seconds and hours and all of these things, but on a cellular level, they're measured in nanoseconds, microseconds, picoseconds, milliseconds. And so to have that energy available throughout the body all the time in those, in that time scale, only water can do this, okay? Water is this energy reservoir. And this is happening, if you think there's like trillions of cells in the body, every one of those cells is having in the order of 50,000 chemical reactions every moment of every day from conception to death. So the amount of energy required in that moment to moment, 50,000 times in 1 second, that's where water is working in delivering that energy. So this happens extremely fast. We don't really get it, as in from our point of view, time scales, but this is that fast acting energy source, the water is, okay? So this is the first, let's say, importance of water that a lot of people wouldn't know about. And this is why we wanna focus, well, we're already talking about that, but this isn't just any old water. This is what we call, it's always been there, of course. It's just that science, let's say, lifted up the blanket and found what was under it at a fourth phase of water. And when you think about water, you know, we all are familiar and got taught in school and these kind of things, the three phases of water, liquid, a vapor, and a solid. And when you look at them molecularly, just, we're not going to go into anything deep about this, but just to talk about, a solid is kind of this hexagonal. Let me just, you can see it on the screen. The solid is this hexagonal shape. Liquid is kind of, some are joined together, some are loose. And then a vapor, well, there are all these little water molecules are all over the place. But there's a fourth phase of water. And this is called liquid crystalline water, okay? Because if you look at it, over here we have, this is ice, okay? Very solid structure, doesn't move. Over here on this side, we have water in the glass. And okay, the water molecules are in there in some arrangement, but we don't really know how. This fourth phase of water is between ice and liquid, and it has the qualities of both. So let me go to, you can see here, it has the structure like ice, but this arrow and these little dotted lines, they're indicating that it can move, okay? So it moves like a liquid, and it has structure like a crystal. And ice is a crystal, ice crystal. And this is the fourth phase of water. And this is the water that, let's say, this brings the importance of water from intuition that now we can explore it, let's say, scientifically. Everybody knows water is important, but to what extent? This is the exploration. And so in the presentation, I'm going to refer to water as liquid crystalline water. Now, you might hear it as, I might also say structured water. So if you hear that, okay, that's the same kind of thing, all right? Now, the next property to understand about that is this is all about coherence. Because remember, coMra therapy, coherent multi-radiances therapy. So under the coMra banner, we're always where everything is all about coherence and supporting the body's own ability to heal itself. And water is also coherent in this fourth phase in a way that we're going to explore. So there's two main qualities for today we want to look at. One is its ability to store and release energy, and we just talked about that to some degree. And we're going to go into that in more depth, and then enhance transmission of information and energy, okay? Now let's start with this slide here. Now let me explain this a little bit, just because It might not be clear for everyone. Pointer, let me get my pen. So this is a representation of this. So these blue lines down here, okay, this is the same as here. So inside, this is like sheets across of all of these liquid crystalline structures, and they're facing into this ordinary water, okay, more or less, just as a diagram. So you're looking at down here, this is the cross section. Now what happens is, and this has been proven experimentally, when you have this liquid crystalline water, this structured water and ordinary water, you can actually run a light bulb off of this. That water can store energy and release energy to do work, okay? So if you think about it, you're kind of transitioning as the liquid crystalline water transitions. What I mean by transitions, as the energy is used in the liquid crystalline water, it transitions to ordinary water. And then as it gets recharged again, it transitions from ordinary water into structured water, okay? And this discharge of the energy, let's say it doesn't destroy it, but it uses up this liquid crystalline state of water. And the energy drawn at the same time is used to do work. The light bulb is a simple demonstration, but inside the body, it's really, this is what's happening everywhere. So this is like a really super convenient and efficient way for the organism, the body, whatever type of life form it is, to handle this energy transition moment to moment, this fourth phase of water. So think about this too. Water, is the quintessence of fluidity. And this isn't just about its ability to flow around things and through a pipe and all these different things. It's also its fluidity to be able to change state so effortlessly. I mean, that's, for me, that's really staggering. How it's so effortless. This, and that's what the quintessence of fluidity is about. This effortlessness to do what needs to be done. So I kind of aspire to that. Not kind of, I would like to have more of that in my own life. Yeah. And because it's so efficient, it does it so efficient. Because if one thing about the coherence too, this is kind of a tangent, but I'm just going to mention it. Because it's so efficient in storing energy, there's no energy loss. There's no communication loss. And we're going to get into that a little more. It's very fascinating. So I want to show you this from a different example this time, from a different angle. So from here, let's say to out here, this is the capacity of the batteries, okay? The batteries have this capacity. And this part out here with all these black dots, this is just little beads put in the water so you can tell the difference in the liquid crystalline part of it. And this is in an actual experiment, and the non-liquid crystalline part. So the fourth phase of water is in here, and this is regular water out here. And as that energy is being used, if you can picture it, the batteries are being used up. So the liquid crystalline water also gets used up, as I was saying earlier. I just wanted to demonstrate it for you. And there's less remaining. So it needs more energy now to recharge again. We'll get into that a little while later, but just for now, so you have this experimental demonstration. So, and the next thing you see here, we have this in the cell. Why that experiment is relevant is because when you look at the cell, all of these little purple guys here are little proteins and different things in the cell. Cell's really packed, jam-packed with this liquid crystalline water. Remember those blue lines? That's the liquid crystalline water indicated by the blue lines. Negative charge, maybe we'll get into that. We'll see. But this just indicates for our purposes right now is that it has the ability to do work. And the cell is always using the components in the cell. Are always using this water to do what they need to do. And I'll show you an example of that. Now, this here, protein folding and unfolding needs liquid crystalline water. Okay, you can see the example on the left, the liquid crystalline water. Notice how when the protein folds, the liquid crystalline water, the blue lines, these disappear. When we look at the one on the right with no liquid crystalline water, this little protein, and I'm going to explain more about the protein in a second, you can see it's trying to change, but it's kind of impotent, doesn't have the ability to change its state. Now, when you think about this in terms of, well, okay, sounds interesting, a protein, how does that affect me? Think about sluggish digestion. Think about when you're not feeling good. Think about impaired cellular metabolism. So if you think back to the functional reserves and you think back to the energy budget, when that energy budget is low, this is not going to happen. Okay? When this doesn't happen, the ripples through the body are that temporary illness on the short term, long-term chronic illness, and here's an example, again, involving the water. When you look at this, this is a cancer tumor, okay? Now, this is a measurement by an MRI. Interesting, you know, everybody thinks, okay, you know, a lot of people think, okay, MRI, but no, not many people know what it does is it actually measures the signature of the water in the body. So they've mapped out all of the different tissues in the body have this signature when they're healthy, and it starts to change in this direction or that direction when it's not healthy. Very fascinating. So this red area, okay, this is treated with low level laser therapy. And what it indicates is the red area is the cancer tumor that has died as a result of the low level laser. Now, why I'm stressing low level laser, this isn't heat. This isn't burning that cancer tumor. This is supporting the body to heal itself. Now, that's one part, Next part, this light blue area here around it, this is an increase in structured water. And then the dark blue area around that is the tumor that hasn't been resolved, it hasn't healed. Now, we're looking at water being involved from the smallest protein folding in the body of just a couple of amino acids, right up to systemic cancer. Water is involved, you know, in terms of health, or if we don't have the structured water, in terms of illness. If we don't have the energy budget, if we don't have the functional reserves in terms of illness. And water, again, central player in all of that.
Gareth.
Yes, please.
Before you move from that slide.
Yeah.
Maybe some of you who attended the courses, you heard about, we talk research done by Karkavi back in 1970s, 80s here in Russia. And what they found in their research at the Oncology Institute in Rostov, they were trying to find different ways how to switch the body from the stress response, which is the state when the body is exhausted, it has no functional reserves, into a training and then activation response. This is the state when the body now can engage immune system in order to destroy the tumor. So interestingly, just through experimentation and without these all these explanations, they found that when they use structured water and they use specifically what they call the magnetized water, which is just plain water, but treated with the magnetic field, static magnetic field. So when they gave patients that magnetized water, they observed that the patients start to switch from that stress response to the training response. And this is what's specifically relevant for the critically ill patients, because when a person is severely ill, you can't really do much with that person. All those invasive therapies, chemo, radiation is hugely invasive. So when a person is in a severely, severely depleted state, you need something which is just gives enough energy boost, you know, just enough to start switching from that extremely low energetic depletion state. And so what they found is that, you know, if you give them structured water, you help, you know, to get those energy dollars, as you got mentioned, to switch, to start shifting, and then you can introduce other more active methods of treatment. So just wanted to mention that one.
Excellent, John. Thank you very much for sharing about that. So you can see whether, you know, like I said, science just lifted the blanket and found out what was under the covers. It's always been there. It's not like this wasn't there before. But they just happened to discover it, which is really interesting for this next part and very relevant. Let me go to the next slide. If you look here, now I'm going to get into a few things here, but if you look here, let me start on the far corner. This is an electron micrograph or micro picture, whatever you want to call it, of a cross section of a capillary. Now, a capillary is the smallest little, places the blood flows in your body. Okay, so it's the goes from the arteries and veins, you know, into these capillaries. Now, those capillaries, if you look at it, if you look at this picture, you can see that inside of here is this red thing. This is a red blood cell. Now, those red blood cells should be a round shape with a concave center. And they actually need to change shape. Like, think about this. These are 6 to 7 microns in diameter, but this opening is only 3 to 4 microns in diameter. So they actually have to, you know, why would nature take something big and squeeze it through something small? You know, it's kind of weird, but they can do it. But it requires energy. Now, you can see in the black and white picture here, especially in the middle, these red blood cells are definitely not a round shape, but they're all squished up. And when they lack the energy required, they can't get through, and you can really note this in the middle. Look how slowly these are moving. This is real time. So this is blood trying to move through. Picture, if you're looking at your hand, that's a red blood cell trying to move through the back of your hand at that slow. That's not healthy. That's not optimal. That's not ideal. So what we're going to explore now is, and this is just an aside, but very interesting, the heart is a little pump. The amount of pressure to pump these through here, you know, when they do the math, and this has been for a long time, no one's understood how it works. But when you do the math, you'd need at least a million times more pressure or something in that order of magnitude for the heart to be able to pump these red blood cells through a pipe that's too big to fit through. So, and I said earlier, you know, science just happened to discover this. So when you look, let's go to the next slide. When you look here, what happened is, and this is a replication of something from before, these Israeli scientists, you know, a lot of science happens by accident, not from like, some of it by, but a lot of it by, oh, wow, okay, we just discovered something. These Israeli scientists were measuring blood flow, like you see in this previous movie where they're watching the blood flow through the capillaries and are measuring this stuff. And at the end of the experiments, they kill the rats, you know. This is how they do things in science. Anyway, and when they kill them, of course, they had the blood flow equipment still hooked up and they weren't paying attention. And someone looks at it and go, the blood is still flowing. Like, well, that can't be possible. How's that possible? Like, the blood is still flowing. So they said, well, it must be something weird with the gear, with the equipment. So they took another rat and they did the same thing. And they ended up doing it 10 times. And every time, the blood continued to flow after the heart was stopped. So obviously, there's more to blood flow than just the heart. Okay? Very amazing discovery. And this, you know, then labs around the world, they replicated it, and this is one replication. So they took a chick embryo here, and they put a little drop of a poison to stop the heart in the center, and then these yellow areas is where they're measuring the blood flow. And you can see this is the blood flow velocity, you know, moving micrometers per second, and it's moving over 1 minute. You know, they stop the heart and it obviously slows down, but now it keeps going. And then they apply non-invasive infrared energy. And what happens? It increases. They stop, slowly it decreases. So what this implies is that infrared energy, external energy, can be applied in order to drive blood flow. Very fascinating. And the blood flows independent of the heart. We won't even go into all the implications of that, but very fascinating. Let me erase that. Now, I want to show you experimentally this in another way so you can see this. So we had a look at the red blood cells squeezing through. Now we talked about this discovery that happened. And now let's look at it from this example here. So this is the arteries in your body, the capillaries, all of these are what they call, they love water. So they're hydrophilic, means them and water, they want to get together. So your arteries and all of this are hydrophilic. And any hydrophilic surface that's sufficiently in love with water, we'll say, will build this liquid crystalline water. Without that liquid crystalline water, blood will not flow around the artery. So you think about that. Water, again, we're talking about this very short-term energy reservoir, because you think about blood flow from, you know, conception to death. That's happening all the time. Each time the energy in that liquid crystalline water gets used, it needs to get recharged. We just saw that, you know, we looked at that. Now, there's another very significant thing here, and I'm just going to touch on this in case somebody observed it. This is a standing body of water. There's no pressure here. Water is flowing without any pressure applied through that artery. Now, think about that in terms of the blood flow a second ago. There's no pressure applied here. This is a static. We'll go back and look at it again because I want to make sure you get this. This is a static chamber, like just put it in your cup of water. Make sure there's water in it so it doesn't have an air bubble like they're doing right there. Put those little black beads in. Remember the ones we looked at earlier that showed the battery and the green liquid. Put the black beads in and water flows because of the liquid crystalline water. It's amazing. Anyway, so we won't go into all the significance of it, but for our purposes right now, just consider that as we go through, because what we're implying is that by applying energy to the body, and you know, a lot of people are familiar with the delta and palm, and now we're getting into the wave. This is resolving, as it says on the slide, hypoxic conditions. What this means is when that, you know, you see on the left here, these red blood cells, when they're trying to move through that tissue, let's say it's into your liver and your energy budget is low and your liver has been providing the energy to get you through your day. I'm just using that as an example. That tissue is now going to be affected in different ways. And one of the ways that often happens is hypoxia. The tissue doesn't get the oxygen and nutrients it needs in, and it can't get the toxins out. So again, when we use these, you know, when we use coMra, it's not about forcing the body. coMra is all about supporting the body's intelligence to do what it already knows how to do. And now we start thinking about water. Water knows exactly what to do. I mean, it's the central player on the whole planet for everything that happens. It's intelligent. It knows what to do. Okay. We all take it for granted. It knows what to do. All we need to do is support it. Okay, this is just one small example looking at the blood. So let me go to the next slide. Now, the second one I wanted to talk about is this enhanced transmission of information and energy. This is really fascinating, especially anyone with an electrical background. You'll be like, wow. Okay, so they take two probes, one on each side of this, you know, structured water, of this liquid crystalline water. And they apply energy to it. They apply information to it. And that information goes through here 100,000 times approximately faster, more efficient, no losses compared to regular water. Now, if you think about that, again, this is one of those, let's say it's very subtle, beautiful aspect of water when we come back to that quintessence of fluidity. because it's so sensitive, it just needs a tiny bit of input. Like, let's say we talk about it in terms of sound. Just a little bit of sound will travel through that water effortlessly, this liquid crystalline water. Just a little tiny signal will travel through that liquid crystalline water effortlessly, because remember, there's no resistance in that water to the signal to flow, okay? Whereas when you take regular water, you take a chaotic, noisy room, you need to raise your voice in order to be heard, because you're competing with so many other things. So this would be an example of coherence, okay? This is a highly, highly coherent setup and effortlessly cooperating with the communication of different signals. And with the body, remember, when we go back to functional reserves, we have functional reserves in terms of the energy that we looked at. We start to look at the functional reserves, energy budget in terms of metabolism, because when we looked at that protein that, you know, was buckled over and it couldn't straighten up, that impotent one, because it didn't have the liquid crystalline water. This is functional reserves in terms of metabolism, a representation of that. And now what we're looking at is energy budget, functional reserves in the context of regulation, because, you know, the body is like the individual and the whole interconnected and working together. And communication is absolutely key to that. Oh, one other side note, just very interesting. There's a material, again, science just uncovered the blanket. It's always been there, called graphene. It's carbon like graphite in your pencil, but it's only one layer thick like this. And it's more conductive than gold, than any conductor on the planet. It's more conductive. And it's super, super strong and really cheap. When you think about it, it's the two basic things on the planet, water and carbon. Carbon is, you know, very basic all over the planet. It's the most conductive when it's in a certain setup. And you think about that in terms of carbon, you have, you know, just charcoal on the one end of the spectrum, diamond on the other, but that's a time scale of millions or billions of years to create that much coherence in carbon. And there's a phase in between them of graphene, and that's the most conductive substance on the earth. So in terms of material, like a solid, whereas liquid crystalline water, yeah, I think I touched on it enough, and the coherence is astronomical, and it's really subtly beautiful too, in my opinion, yeah. So let's look at what happens when we interrupt communication. So again, I just want to show you these blue lines here. I just did it in a different way to represent. Picture that is here. So this is the cross section of all of this, okay? So they're both liquid crystalline water, these little ovals. They're just representations of these, just to make it simple. So if we take an anesthetic, a local anesthetic lidocaine, so you're going in to get a dental work done, and they give a little shot of lidocaine in here, in your gum, and then, you know, the dentist taps on your face, you're like, oh, I don't feel anything. They're like, okay, great, we can get to work on that. I want you to just pay attention. What that's doing is it's destroying or using up it gets rid of the liquid crystalline water. If you do this in an experiment, you put lidocaine in liquid crystalline water, it's instantly turned into regular water. Now think about that. We just talked about communication being 100,000 times more efficient in this structured water, this liquid crystalline water. And as soon as we stop that, we don't have the same amount of communication. Now the body, Arjan talked about a minute ago about going from stress response to training response, if you remember. And he's talking about that in terms of using that liquid crystalline water. When the body's in a stress response, either A, it'll have to turn the signal up so loud to try and get the message through, or B, the body's in such a terrible state that it has to turn the signal down in order just to cope. When it turns the signal down so you can survive, we're not saying this is a fact, but it certainly looks like your body cannot, I see it as your body cannot conduct a signal through, because if it turns up, let's say there's no liquid crystalline water right here, in order to get the signal through there, it's got to turn the volume up exponentially. As it turns the body, the volume up exponentially in a stressed body, that body can't cope with it. So now it's got to sacrifice urine pain. You can't stop the pain. You're in chronic illness. You can't stop the illness because the body's in a stressed state and can't turn the volume up to get to the state where it can start to heal. When we look at this in terms of liquid crystalline water, what we're seeing is the liquid crystalline, the coherence, is necessary in order to conduct the signal in a way that the body can operate in, so you can have a good life, basically. Now, the thing with the lidocaine too, just to think about it, if you keep injecting lidocaine into a tissue, it damages it. Not because of the chemicals, but because the structured water, it can't build structured water. And if you think about that protein, it can't change shape. If it can't change shape, the metabolism of the cell decreases and decreases till it eventually dies. And the tissue, if you keep injecting this local anesthetic, it will die. Like, that's just fact. So very interesting, very significant for our health. Again, I said at the beginning, I'm saying it right now, you can't really overstate this stuff. I mean, and it's so simple when you think about how convoluted and complicated everything gets with these branches of science. Now, I'm not saying they're not necessary per se, but when things can be shown simply and accurately, this makes a lot more sense. So this is, I don't want to go into any more with the communication because it gets into physics and it's not that easy to explain. So we're going to move on to where does this liquid crystalline water come from? Well, I already tipped you off to that quite a bit. And is there anything we can do to make it? Yes, I already tipped you off to that quite a bit too, but let's go into that, let's say, directly. And with respect to coMra, there's two main methods to do this. Now, one is passive and the other is active. What do I mean by passive? So remember from the video at the beginning, coMra wave is self-powered using the ambient. And what I mean by ambient when I'm looking around in that video is all the electrosmog we're surrounded by. It's using that, taking it, and we'll get into what it does. We already touched on it. It's using that. You don't have to do anything. You're just wearing it, and it's doing all the work for you. You don't have to change batteries. You don't have to charge it. You don't have to do anything but wear it, put it in your pocket, put your drink on it, whatever the case. Whereas with Delta and with Palm, you need to do something. You need to turn it on, put it on your arm, like Dennis is doing there. Do something with it. So this is what we mean by active. There's other meanings to it, but for today, and there's more to it than that, but for today, this is two methods of building this liquid crystalline water in our body. Very simple. Now, this passive method with the coMra wave, two beneficial functions, protective function and a generative function. Now, we're not going to get into the protective function beyond to say, look, why we need it. Well, we need it because we're surrounded by all of this environment we live in now, with 3G, 4G, and 5G coming on the way. Some people, it's already in effect, Wi-Fi, all kinds of different things, GSM, all these things. This is like the background environment we live in all the time now. And this is taxing our energy budget continuously. In other words, that functional reserves is always being drawn on by all these. We're not going to go into specifics, but water is going to be involved, as we looked at to some degree, in every single one of these processes on the slide. So you can go on the internet. It's a bit of a depressing topic, good to know about, but depressing topic in the sense of, you know, how much damage it's having on people's bodies. And this is most of these studies, and there's thousands of them, show small effect but cumulative. In other words, if you have one phone call in your life, well, not really much effect. Whereas everyone's having a lot of phone calls. We're in the environment all the time. Those are cumulative effects. They just keep building. And if you think about the energy budget and there's no way to replenish it, we don't have strategies and ways to replenish that energy budget, it's only a matter of time before we hit zero and draw on the cells. You know, disease is kind of like, if you look at it a certain way, it's also actually a survival strategy of the body, because once it hits zero, okay, I'm going to sacrifice my knee health in order to maintain my systemic health. And this is very, this comes back actually, I didn't mean to go on that tangent, but now that I'm talking about it, when the body's in balance, that balance in different systems and organs, when we talk about functional reserves and regulations and all of these things, it's such an intricate, delicate, fine, yet resilient, robust balance, okay? And this is where the water is so key, because that balance moment to moment, millisecond, microsecond, nanosecond, and nanosecond being maintained is done by the water in the body. This fourth phase, its ability to transition back and forth from the three to the four. You know, another way, esoterically, the relationship between the three and the four is unbelievable with water. So anyway, sorry, that's another tangent, but it's very fascinating. So you can look at the Wi-Fi stuff on your own. There's definitely lots of harm with it. It's cumulative. I'm just going to show you one example of, so you get it visually. This here was the intensity going up, let's say, okay. Now you can see this is 4 second division here in the middle of a phone call. So we're looking at just 8 seconds. This is the different intensities of that signal of a phone call, where the phone is ringing, then the person is talking, they're listening down here. So you can see, this is all the time. So whether it's right by your head or over there, someone's talking about you, this is the environment we're in. And the thing about this is it's a really chaotic signal, not coherent in any way, shape, or form in terms of the body. And remember that liquid crystalline water is super sensitive to energy, to signals, to information. So it's impacting that all the time. So we need to have ways, strategies to look after that, okay? Now, when you look here, okay, so we take these, let's say, all the different things in the environment, and this is the permanent environment now, for better or for worse. You know, I say for better because it's a lot of convenience for it, but there's a trade-off, of course. And I'm not saying we get rid of it, but we need to have strategies to look after ourselves in this environment, okay? And you'll see here, this is coMra Wave technology, and what it's doing is it imprints the coherence in the form. And this is just an artistic representation for you of it, so you have something to visualize. It's imprinting the coherence in the type of a vortex, and not just a vortex spin in one way, but in three dimensions, anyway, into the water. This is creating liquid crystalline water. Now, it's not like a big sheet in the water. This is in microclusters, because, you know, when you think of water molecules, they're super, super tiny, okay? When you think about how you're 99% water, it's because, let's say, a protein is the size of, you know, your house, and a water molecule is the size of your lawnmower, you know, or smaller. So by population, it's all water, but they're very small, so that's why there's so many of them. And they act as one in the body, which makes them that main character, the whole thing. Everything else is support for the water, and the water in turn looks after everything else. So then how do we do that? How do we take care of the water? So coMra Wave generative function, it absorbs instead of blocking, okay? So it's taking all of this Wi-Fi and this kind of stuff, it's absorbing that instead of blocking it, instead of just deflecting it off somewhere else to your neighbor, and it's transforming instead of dissipating. In other words, instead of that just wilting down to zero, it's taking the energy and utilizing it so we can benefit, okay? Now, again, we come back to reduce the electrosmog, increase the liquid crystalline water, functional reserves are going to increase, and the energy available to you to live your life, to realize your own dreams, to enjoy your family, do whatever it is you want to do is there. Whereas when it's not there, you can't really do it, okay? And what I wanted to say too with that is, because this is passive and, let's say, Delta and coMra active, they're really going to impart a lot more energy at one time compared to the coMra Wave. coMra Wave is like you're continuously putting a few bucks in that bank. 24/7, you're making deposits in your energy bank account 24/7. Whereas coMra Delta and, you know, coMra Palm, you're making big deposits, which keep giving you returns, let's say, both in terms of benefit and also the functional reserves stay increased after treatment, but it does go down. But it's a bigger scale investment in all senses. coMra Wave, smaller energy budget increase, but happening all the time without any effort. So if you want to, we didn't want to take up the time today going into the technical research and all that. You can read about that on our website. You go to that knowledge center, you click on that, go to the explored research, dissolved oxygen tests are there, nuclear magnetic resonance tests are there, microwave signature tests, then microwave spectrum analysis, water dynamics, those are all there. And what these are all about, these are looking at the two aspects of coMra Wave in terms of this electrosmog, what it's doing with it, how it reduces the electrosmog you're exposed to. It doesn't eliminate it, okay? It reduces it. And then it looks at when we transform it, okay, this shows the transformation is occurring and here's how this is happening and here's the water dynamics and dissolved oxygen. You could look at that in terms of, just as an example, lots of people, when they get their Delta and they got that coaster and it's got the multicolored imprint on it, you put your water on that, you live in a place like Miami, we'll say, in the US, where the water's, you know, it doesn't taste very good, in my opinion, anyway, and lots of people. You put your water on there and you taste it, you're going to notice the difference. So it's not just in the body, but you can also notice it with your drinking water, okay? Now, when we get to active method, well, I already talked about that. Now, there's one other thing we definitely want in our strategy when it comes to our functional reserves. And that is our emotions increase or decrease the coherence in water too. Now, this very, he died a while ago, Masaru Emoto. He did a lot of experiments about this. He's ridiculed, by the way, absolutely ridiculed and poo-pooed for all of his, what he put out there. And, well, let's say after he died, he was exonerated or vindicated because other labs around the world said, okay, well, let's try it. Let's try it out for ourselves. Can we replicate this? And yes, they could. And what they did, you'll see here, you can take water and you can, depending on your emotional intent you direct at that water, you can influence the structure of the water. Now think about that. We just talked about the functional reserves, energy budget, how sensitive, how willing water is to participate in anything going on, and it'll do everything it can. So, you know, I'm preparing for this presentation, I'm making slides, I'm like, oh, Garrett, you fool. Like, you made another mistake. Oh. That's the direct effect you could see on the slide there. I'm impacting my own functional reserves. I mean, many of you out there, you know, if you talk to me, I've said, look, TLC, you got to give yourself that tender love and care. Of course, that applies. I put one finger here, just four pointing back at me, of course, you know. I have to give myself the TLC. And it's not that easy for us when we get conditioned to be in the negative, but it's worth our while to pay attention to what we say to ourselves, so that we can start to move that. You know, maybe you start from zero and you're moving to one. Maybe you're at 100 already. Well, why not go to 101 in terms of giving yourself that love and care? And you can do this with your emotions. It doesn't cost you anything, except for you got to invest your awareness in that. By awareness, I mean, you know, thoughts and emotions can run in autopilot for a lot of us. And that autopilot comes from repeated patterns. So let's say you drive in the car, okay? How many times have you gone through a light and you're like, well, it must have been green, you know, but I don't remember it. This is what I mean by autopilot. That's one aspect. The other thing is we can suppress our knowledge of our emotions. You know, it's not, let's say it's not safe to be angry. So then I'm not going to be angry anymore. So anytime anger comes up, I suppress that because it's not safe. Now, that might have been from when I was a little kid, but remember I said earlier, things reaching their sell-by date and this journey of adjustment, that might have been applicable when I was a little kid for my safety or survival, let's say. But now as an adult, this is a whole different kettle of fish. We could do something about this in a new way. So anyway, I won't beat that to death. Emotions, and this is all demonstrated scientifically and all of this as well. So, you know, we've been looking at water in the body, but I want to, it doesn't matter what kind of organism we're talking about, whether it's you and I, animals, plants, everything is used. Water is the central player in every single life form on this planet, okay? So you can see here these experiments, the plants make use of water. It's not that we gave them more energy. We just restructured the water. And if you think about that in terms of functional reserves and energy budget for the plant, that means the plant had more of its own energy budget available in order to grow more healthy, you know, to withstand more the cold, to grow a bigger root system, a more firm foundation. You think of a plant, the firm foundation. This is part of our functional reserve. So we come back to the coMra effect, okay? We're not telling the body what to do. We're not telling water what to do. Instead, we're acknowledging that it knows what to do after however bazillion years, you know? Why don't we work with that? And this is what coMra is all about. Let's support that intelligence and let's be intelligent in that ourselves and do things in a way that uplifts us and people around us. And this is what we meant by spread the word at the beginning, okay? Spread the word in terms of what water, you know, you're having a conversation with someone. Be interesting. I'm sure they'd be interested. Everyone wants to know things that they don't know about water. So you could share that. So I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much for your paying attention and participating in this. So we're going to open it up to questions now. So if you have any questions and they're in the chat, Avril will probably have looked at those, and I'm going to stop sharing right now.
Hi, Garrett.
Hi, Avril.
Just one question here from Lola. She's just asking, is the wave technology the same as the what was the coMra coasters, or has it been enhanced?
Thank you for the question, Lola. It's, let's say, more efficient in creating coherence now. So yes, enhanced, but not in an easy to explain way. Great question. Is there anything else, or was that the only one?
That was the only one in the chat. Okay. So otherwise, if anybody has any questions, I thought of something with respect to June, what June asked me a couple weeks ago with respect to detox. She wanted to hear more about detox in general with coMra. But detox is very important, and the coMra wave would be very important in the detox process. The structured water would make the detox way more efficient. So I don't know if you want to talk about that, because June wanted to hear more about detox in general.
I'll just mention something about it in terms of, if you think of detox as in you got to get that toxin out, the lymphatic system is like more water it's more water in the lymphatic system than even the blood. So this is an important component. When you think of liquid crystalline water, remember we had the thing about the conductance, okay? The sheet on the conductance. Think about that conductance as well as its ability to move things. That liquid crystalline water, what happens, I didn't get into this, but it has the ability. I'll actually show you the slide. June, 1 second. Cheers. I think it's this one. Let's share that and see if that works. You see that? I'm sharing my screen.
No, I see the screen, but it's at the end.
Okay, yeah, I'm going to go to the correct slide. I just want to make sure I had the right one. Okay. So when you think of toxins in the cell, now K is potassium, and I'll do it over here. This K is potassium. This is sodium. Liquid crystalline water, and a cell is mostly going to be potassium, and it lets in the sodium selectively. And this is just one example, okay? Because everything in the body, remember I talked about this delicate balance. So that's held in a delicate balance through this liquid crystalline water, because it says we want, it adjusts its level of liquid crystallineness, so to speak, and that preferentially excludes or lets in different chemicals into the cell. It's very fascinating. So when the liquid crystal, if you think of someone with rigor mortis, okay, when someone dies, not someone, if you think of a body, although I've had, you know, my arm's gone to sleep, felt like rigor mortis in my arm before. When the body is dead, the liquid crystalline structure dissipates. As it dissipates, rigor mortis sets in, the body becomes stiff. What's happening on a cellular level is all the sodium is getting inside the cell from outside the extracellular space, okay? So the space between the cells, it goes from there into the cell. If you take a muscle cell, as soon as you put sodium in the cell, it makes the muscle cell go from able to flex to rigor mortis. So this is just one example. Why I'm using that is because, we go to the next slide, you can see as the sodium gets in, the liquid crystalline structure is all gone from liquid crystalline to just random water molecules all over the place. And if you think about that in terms of toxins, I'm not saying it's the only thing, but it's directly related to toxins in the body, because a healthy cell will exclude those things that need to be excluded. Now, of course, you know, there's mimics and all of these things where you get an isotope of halon that substitutes in for iodine, and that's going into your thyroid, and this isn't good, and these kind of things. But the body, yeah, there's a lot that can be done in terms of the liquid crystalline water there.